Hey guys, welcome to the Hampton Hatchery. My name is Scott Finney, I'm the hatchery manager.
I'm Becca, I'm a fish culturist here in New Hampton.
Chris Perkins, also a fish culturist.
Jack Nisby, also a fish culturist.
Natalie, also a fish culturist.
Today we're going to be showing you guys how we spawn the brook trout. We've got some males and female brook trout here. We're going to kind of show you the different characteristics of the two, the males and the females. We're going to show you the techniques that we use to take the eggs and fertilize the eggs. And we're just going to take it right through the stages. So sit back and enjoy and be fun.
All right.
What we've got here for you is we've got two brook trout in here, Rome strain. We've got a male brook trout and a female brook trout. As you can see, he's quite a bit larger than the females. But if you look at the body style, you'll see how these look more a little bit like a football. They kind of got the big hunchback, they got the pointy nose, they got the kype starting to show, which is the hook jaw, which is obviously usually a male characteristic. See how that's starting to grow out. Usually after a fish becomes 2 years old, that will get bigger and bigger as the fish goes along. Now his colors are a little bit brighter than the female. He's got the real white fins on the end. He's got the real red belly. If you tip him over, he's got the black and white belly there. One good way to tell is looking at the nose. The nose and the jaw of the male is a pretty easy way. You can see they have a pointier nose.
Next to the female, see it's a lot more rounded off, and then the body shape is a lot thicker side to side. Just a big belly full of eggs, and you know, she'll be...
How many eggs do these have in
2,500 to 3,000 fish usually. Uh-huh. So what you do to collect the eggs, basically you kind of hold them like so if you're a righty, and the eggs will come right out of the vent here. So generally what we'll do, we'll stage a bucket right here and then just kind of apply steady pressure down the belly toward the vent, and then you'll start to see the eggs squirt out.
Well, right now they're flopping in the flopping table right now, and what this is doing is making them tired. They're not getting injured this way, they're just getting a little tired, so it's easier to handle for us, because if we pick them up right now, they'll be flopping, we'll drop them. We don't really want to drop them. We're going to grab a female first, put the eggs in the bucket, and then we'll come over and grab the males and put the milk in the bucket. After you're done, you got your eggs in there. Easy way to tell, if you look at the female's belly, it looks like a deflated balloon. That's how we know she has no more eggs to give, and you kind of can feel the eggs inside too. But once they're all done, you put them in the tank over here to separate them. Then we go over and we grab the male. Easy way, that kite. And you feel a little bit of a squeeze. You can see the white, that's milk. That's coming out. That's going to fertilize the eggs. And then he's all done, then we separate him, take our eggs, and we just give him a little bit of a swirl to get all that milk through all the eggs to fertilize all of these.
Now if you guys look in here, you can see how the milk is floating around on there, touching all the eggs so that it gets good fertilization. What I'm doing here is after the guys have them all fertilized, we put them up here, we kind of let them sit for about 15 minutes or so. We want to make sure that milk touches all the eggs so that everything can be fertilized. What I'm doing here is I've got my brood spoon and I'm taking a subsample of each batch that we take. Now the reasoning for that is that these fish, as we stock them out, as we use them, are going to need to be replaced. So by taking a subsample of these fish, it kind of gives us the best genetics, the best out of each fish that we take. Some fertilized, I just want to take it like kind of right through the middle, and that's my subsample. And I keep them separated for our brood, and that will be the fish that you'll see here in the next 3 years. They'll be the ones that we're taking the eggs from. Becca's inside and she's got some iodine tubs in there. The next process from here, we've got our first take. We're going to take it inside. We're going to disinfect all these eggs, make sure they're clean, they're free of parasites, clean of any disease or anything like that. And then we're going to water harden them, and we'll put them in the water hardening tubs. And Becca will show you guys that whole process. So follow me, and we'll show you this next. How are you? We got some eggs for you.
When the eggs first come in from the hatchery from outside, we have to record the time that they come in. And so we have a setup sheet. And so at the end, we'll mark the number of females, number of males, same kind of sheet that they're collecting out there. But I need to record the time they come into the hatchery and then a couple other stages along the way. So I gotta make sure I get that when they first come in. And then I'll take the lid off and then take the brood out. And over here I have iodine solution made up. And what that does is it's gonna wash all the excess milk and ovarian fluid off of the eggs because that will allow them to water harden properly. So I'll take them over the strainer and I've got up and I'll just rinse the iodine. It's watered down iodine. There's a specific formula that we follow. So I'll just give them a rinse just to make sure the fluid comes off. And then they'll go right into the bath and sit there. And then I'll take batches of these eggs. And you gotta be really gentle with them. You don't wanna pop any of the shells or cause any of them to get squished or anything. So you just kind of do them in batches. And it's gonna be the same thing I just did to the brood. So we're just gonna wash them off. Kind of get enough liquid in there to kind of suspend all the eggs, enough to cover them all. And then I just give them a light roll. You don't need to be too hard with it. It's just to kind of make sure that all the ones that were stuck together kind of get some of that iodine on them. And then this bucket that they went into actually has a strainer bottom so that I can get rid of the iodine wash. So then I'll just take these guys, hold them over the bucket, and then using the same wash, I'll just kind of put them in there, splash them down, make sure they get in the pool. Definitely not a job you can stay dry at. So then before I put this back in the bucket, I don't want any of this excess fluid or anything going on to the next batch, so I'll just dump it. I won't give it a rinse or anything because again, I'm doing batches, so. And this is the strainer bottom we have. So again, I'll just continue to kind of wash them. Be really gentle with them. So then for this one, we keep our brood separate. So the brood fish are in, future brood fish are in the tubes. So we'll actually lay them down in the compartment over here. And the eggs go into the water hardening tub. It doesn't matter which section you put them in. It's just you don't want to put too many in there because if there's too much weight in there, the ones on the bottom don't do as well. And you could squish them because they're so sensitive right now. So you should just put one bucket per basket to keep it simple. And after they've soaked in this iodine, you can start to see the ones that are turning white, which are the dead eggs, and any shells that formed. You can really see them once they're laid down in the water hardening tub. So now these guys, we'll record the time again, and then we'll leave them in there for 2 hours to get a little bit more of a hard shell. The next step after we water harden is to do the Von Baer reading. And what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna dip it in the trough. And then I'm gonna line up a series of eggs. It's gonna be a single row, no overlap and no water in it. And I'll do a count and I'll do it 3 times. And then we have a chart that tells us based off the number of eggs in there, how many eggs per ounce, so that when we do our conversion and lay them down, we'll get an estimate of how many eggs we actually have. Get a scoop. And then I usually just hold my picker over it, stop the eggs from falling out. Move over to the table where there's light and then line them up. back over and scoop out the extras. Once they're in a row and there's no gaps, then I'll just count them, 34. And so you just go where you got the size, so it's 34. So then that tells you that there's 381 eggs per ounce. So then I'll just scoop some out. And then drop them in. Puts me about 18, so I'll need a little bit more. That one's at 24, but yeah. Perfect. 22.
New Hampton basically takes the eggs at their facility. We try to get one of the last batches of eggs that they have. So they may spawn over a 4 to 8 week period. We want to make sure that we're getting either the second to the last or the last batch of eggs. The idea for that is, again, with temperature, everything kind of varies. So the colder the water is, the longer we can actually hold those eggs. And here we've got probably some of the coldest water in the state. We get down to around 36 or 38 degrees. So that hatch house basically is able to hold on to those eggs a little bit longer, which works better for the trout in the classroom program. Otherwise, the eggs would start hatching out probably sometime in February. And the way we do it right now, we're basically able to get it, probably buy them another 6 weeks worth of time so that they're hatching out a little bit later so that teachers can release the eggs, now fish, into those brooks and streams and other water bodies sometime in May or June. Once we get the eggs here, we're picking them daily. We're getting rid of any mortality. And there's certain times of the year where we're gonna get bigger spikes than others. Towards the end, we might only get like a half a dozen eggs per day. Right now, we're getting somewhere between 200 and 300 a day. We have to make sure that we're picking those eggs of mortality every day, getting rid of any potential mortalities that are gonna cause any kind of fungus issues, because that one egg is gonna kill 10 eggs today, and then tomorrow it's gonna kill 100. It just spreads like wildfire. So even though you may not have a lot of dead eggs in there, if you don't pick your mortality, it's gonna spread to your good eggs and cause your good eggs to have a high mortality. We're picking them every day. We're checking temperature every day. I'm looking at the developmental index probably about once a week, which is what the trout in the classroom uses. But we're looking at the developmental index to say, okay, well, the eggs are eyed enough that we can basically start to shock them and then get them ready to be shipped out to the kid. And that's basically, you know, the gist of it. It's not like it's very in-depth, but it's just a lot of daily maintenance. It might only take us like 10, 15 minutes a day, but without that daily maintenance, we can lose everything, and that's not why we're here.
So the next stage in development in what happens in the incubator trays is they are eye eggs at this point. So you can see the eyes of the brook trout have developed. You can kind of see the black, two little black dots forming there. And then the next stage is the development of the fry inside the egg. So you can start to see the formation of the fish from the eyes to the back to the tail. And then our next stage is sac fry when they hatch out. So you'll be able to see the orange, bright orange sack, and that's their food source. So they'll feed off that as they continue to develop. And then we have, these are still sack fried, but they're at a later stage. Pretty soon they'll lose that, or it becomes very minimal, and then we'll pond them into the raceway tanks.